Hi, remember the piezo preamp I built a few videos ago? If you followed that tutorial and you built your own preamp, then you need to watch this video, please. Don't skip a minute. This is important if you're using your pre with a guitar amp. Part of the reason I built a piezo preamp for my cigar box guitars, which all have piezo pickups, was to snatch my bass back from the capacitive jaws of piezo pickups. The problem is my DIY preamp snatched back too much of my bass, including unusable sub bass, and then boosted it. Originally, I thought,
so what? I'm not having any issues with my boosted sub bass. When recording my CBGs direct, I use a high pass filter in my DAW. Plus, I'm not getting mud or distortion from my guitar amps because guitar amps can't reproduce frequencies below 70 hertz, right?
So obviously, I wasn't concerned until I ran into an article by guitaristnextdoor.com. See my video description box for the link. In the context of using your bass with your guitar amp, the article said that sub bass, when too loud, can damage guitar amps. So after learning this, I couldn't allow sub bass to pass through this DIY preamp unchallenged. And I, of course, had to find a solution that I could share with all of you. Luckily, I was already tinkering with a super simple and cheap high pass filter circuit when I ran into the info from Guitarist Next Door. Even before I knew sub bass at high levels could damage guitar amps, I wanted to reduce the boosted sub bass from my pre because I surmised that my guitar effects pedals may perform better without sub bass from my amped up CBG signals. My mission at this point, however, was to test this circuit's effectiveness at reducing enough of the boosted sub bass from my piezo pre to keep our guitar amps healthy. So let's get on with the mission. Through research, I learned that one can build a passive high pass filter using only two components, an unpolarized capacitor and a resistor. As you can see, I'm not exaggerating when I say that the circuit is very simple. The only thing I needed to work out before building the circuit was capacitor and resistor values that would give me the cutoff frequencies I needed to reduce sub bass. Anything between 80 and 100 hertz should work. To narrow down my search, I decided to use components I already had at hand. I have a ton of small value unpolarized ceramic capacitors and carbon film resistors from other projects. By the way, you can get packs of these components for cheap on Amazon. So, to save money, I wanted to see which cap resistor combo I already owned would give me the cutoff frequencies I wanted. Now, to figure that out, I needed to run my cap and resistor values through this scary formula. Luckily, I found this high pass filter calculator on omnicalculator.com because I know that I wasn't going to win the battle against this equation a few dozen times. The link to the calculator is in the video description box. Through some experimentation, I learned that in my case, the most effective way to use the calculator was to enter my cap and cutoff frequency values into the formula to see what resistor values I needed. I have a tub full of resistors, so I was bound to have the resistor values the calculator spit out. You, however, can enter the resistor and cap values to calculate the cutoff frequencies instead, or you can calculate the cap values by entering the cutoff frequency and resistor values as well. You only need to enter two values into the calculator for it to work, and you can choose what to enter based on what components you have on hand or what you can source online. Anyway, I was right. I had the resistors I needed to work with the cap values I owned, and I matched up my resistor and cap values in envelopes based on what cutoff frequencies they yielded. From these envelopes, I built and tested three circuits. One that yielded an 80.63 Hz cutoff frequency, and another that yielded an 106.1 Hz cutoff frequency, and another that yielded 153 Hz cutoff frequency. Here's a quick look at how I put together my test circuits. Since I haven't purchased a quality breadboard for audio applications yet, I know, I opted to create a quick and dirty test circuit with a scrap board I had laying around, some copper tape, which I have in abundance for crafting, and 2/4-inch TS connectors, one male and one female, which I cannibalized from an old project. The male connector, the input of my high-pass filter circuit, would plug into the output of my preamp, and the female connector, the output of my passive high-pass filter circuit, would connect into my audio interface via an instrument cable. I matched the lanes in the schematic with the copper tape, checked the lanes for continuity, applied flux to the tape, added solder to the areas where my component leads go. I solder at 700 degrees Fahrenheit using 6040 solder, by the way, and then soldered a cap and corresponding resistor onto the board. When I finished testing a particular cap and resistor combo, then I desoldered them and then soldered a new cap and resistor combo onto the board for testing. I set up my test by plugging a piezo CBG into my piezo preamp, and then I sent the output of my preamp into my passive high pass filter circuits. The filtered signals from my circuits would then be sent into my audio interface to be digitally recorded and analyzed in my DAW. To have a point of reference for testing my circuits, I recorded my CBG through my preamp without any high pass filter circuits and without adding any type of EQ in my DAW. This was my control recording. Then I copied the control recording and applied an 80 Hz high pass filter it through my DAW's parametric equalizer, which I know from mixing with my 2.1 monitoring system effectively reduces sub-bass from my CBG recordings. You can see how much sub-bass my DAW's parametric high-pass filter has reduced by comparing the waveforms of my control recording and this filtered recording. This filtered recording, which has been cleaned up by my DAW's parametric high-pass filter, is my optimal recording, the recording that probably represents the best possible result I can get from my passive high-pass filter circuits. The performance of all of my high-pass filter circuits will be compared to this, my optimal recording. Let's look at the high-pass filter circuit with the 80.63 Hz cutoff. The waveform is similar to the waveform of my control recording, which isn't good. When we look at this recording through my parametric EQ graph, you can see that almost none of my sub-bass frequencies have been filtered out. Let's listen to this recording. Needless to say, this circuit failed the test. Let's move on to the high-pass filter circuit with the 106.1 cutoff. Look at the waveform. You can tell that this circuit performed much better than the first circuit. When we look at this recording through my parametric EQ graph, however, too much sub-bass, in my opinion, is still passing through. Let's listen to this recording. This circuit performed better, but I wouldn't say that it passed the test. Let's see if we get better results from the passive high-pass filter circuit with the 153.92 Hz cutoff. Looking at the waveform, I can tell that this circuit removed too much of my signal. This recording looks like one that I made without my preamp, which is weak and lacks usable bass. Let's skip the parametric EQ graph and take a listen. Yep, I was right. This sounds like a piezo cigar box guitar that isn't running through a preamp. This circuit also failed the test. So at this point in the experiment, I was left with two failing circuits and one, the 106.1 Hz cutoff circuit, that almost passed. I thought I had to go back to the drawing board, but then my husband made a brilliant suggestion.
Why not just put two of the 106 high-pass filters together?
I thought,
that's so simple, it just might work.
So I combined two of the 106.1 Hz filters. This is what the circuit looks like. And then I plugged it into my preamp and made a recording. I took a look at the waveform and noticed that it looks similar to that of my optimal recording. I was very optimistic. Let's listen to my optimal recording and then to my new circuits recording back to back. Okay, the doubled up 106.1 circuit passed the test. Woo! Okay, so I'll be adding this circuit to my next piezo preamps to make sure that all of my piezo pre's are guitar amp safe. So if you built the DIY piezo pre from a few videos ago, please integrate this high pass filter circuit into your pre circuit. or create a little plug-in circuit for your pre as I did in this video. Also, please pass on this information to anyone who can use it and comment on this video so YouTube will suggest it to more people. Okay, so as a little victory dance for this video, I'm going to be making two recordings using my doubled up passive high-pass filter circuit. First recording, I'm going to make cigar box guitar plugged into my preamp, preamp plugged into my little plug-in high-pass filter circuit, and then direct into my audio interface into my DAW. Then the second recording, which I'm going to treat as overdub, I'm going to plug CVG into piezo preamp. Piezo preamp goes into my plug-in high-pass filter, passive high-pass filter circuit, and then I'm going to record the output of my guitar amp, which now should be protected from that pesky sub bass from my piezo preamp. Okay, so here we go. Anyway, thanks for making it to the end. I really appreciate that. Have a wonderful day, and I'll see you in the next video. Chaito.